This is a story about an Australian boy missing in a Syrian jail.
Yusuf's a beautiful boy. She's my baby.
Yusuf Zahab, a Sydney school kid plunged into an IS nightmare. Most of the Australians who lived under the Islamic State group and survived its destruction have been held without charge or trial since 2019, including children.
Where are you from?
Australia.
Yusuf is a child, for God's sake. He was a child when it was taken over. He had no agency and he's been left to rot and disappear.
Yusuf became the face and the voice of the lost boys of Syria.
I'm Australian, 17 years old. I just got shot by Apache. My head's bleeding. I have an injury in my head, in my hand.
He was even reported dead.
We had grieved, the family had grieved.
Only Yusuf's story didn't end there.
I hope you find the truth. I hope you find out the story. If he's with us, where is he? What's his current status? And if he's not with us, what happened to him? We want to know.
I've come to Western Sydney, where Yusuf Zahab grew up, and where one member of his extended family has been leading the charge to find him.
Oh, look, he's a kid.
He's a kid here. He's younger, face painting. You know, any Australian child with a school fate gets their face painted, and there he is, happy, smiling kid, which is the way I remember him. This is a happy, smiling kid.
Kamal Dabusi has not only been pushing for information about Yusuf, he's been advocating for all the families of Australians stuck in Syria since the fall of the Islamic State group in 2019.
Yes, this shot I know well. That's when Yusuf's niece was born, Yusuf's mum. And there's Yusuf there.
Yusuf was an ordinary kid who loved playing dress-ups, riding his bike, and hanging out with his cousins. In 2015, he was just settling into year 7 when he was taken on a family holiday to Lebanon and Turkey. It would turn into a nightmare. Yusuf's older brother and sister were already in Syria, living under the Islamic State's self-declared caliphate. Kamal says the family went to the border to try to take the sister home, but were instead coerced into IS territory.
They did not choose to go. And certainly Yusuf, at that age, doesn't make a choice to go. He gets taken, and that's his story.
Yusuf would spend the next 4 years living under the Islamic State group. It's estimated more than 40,000 foreigners came to join the organisation or live in territory under its rule. Amongst them, Yusuf's much older brothers, Muhammad Zahab and later Khalid Zahab. Muhammad was a senior IS member and a recruiter. Kamal believes that together, Khalid and Muhammad were responsible for the Zahab family ending up in Syria. This includes younger brother Yusuf, sister Sumaya, parents Hisham and Amina, and Khaled's wife, Mariam Dabusi, who is Kamal's daughter.
Khaled obviously was my son-in-law. I quite liked him. He was working. He was just a normal boy growing up in Australia. He'd married my daughter, and he's my grandchildren's father. And I try and remember the good and not focus or dwell on the bad, even though clearly we've paid a big price for those bad decisions.
But by 2018, Muhammad and Khalid Zahab were dead. A year later, the Islamic State group lost the Battle of Barghouz, their last stronghold, and the remainder of the Zahab family emerged from the rubble.
As the fall of Barghouz came, the men were taken at one of the checkpoints. Yusuf was then separated from his mother. His mother and his sister were taken initially to Al-Hol camp. And Yusuf, we didn't know where he was. That's when the search started and began for Yusuf at that stage.
Yusuf, who was now aged 15, disappeared into the Kurdish prison system.
How does a boy go missing?
That's a good question. I went to visit in 2019 and tried with all my networks to find Yusuf. International press have been asking for him. Aid agencies have been asking for him. The UN Special Rapporteur has been asking about him. He is well known to the Kurds. How they would miss him, misplace him, lose him in the system, it doesn't make any sense to me.
For lack of information, what does your gut tell you about Yusuf?
My gut tells me that he is no longer with us, but the worst case is that no one's telling us.
We are going to Syria to look for Yusuf. What are you hoping?
I hope you find the truth. I hope you find out the story. If he's with us, where is he? What's his current status? And if he's not with us, what happened to him? If you were to find Yusuf and you're able to meet with Yusuf, I would want you to tell him two things. His family dearly loves him, and he's not forgotten.
After I cross the Tigris River from Iraq, I arrive in Syria. But this region isn't ruled from Damascus. Instead, the Kurdish forces that defeated IS still control this northeastern pocket. They call it Rojava. Local Kurdish journalist Mustafa Al-Ali is helping me search for Yusuf. And the first step is to set up a meeting with the SDF, the Syrian Democratic Forces. The SDF controls the prisons that hold an estimated 9,000 men who are Islamic State group suspects. And they control the detention camps where approximately 55,000 affiliated family members live.
What will it take to find information about him?
It's really hard because like we have to speak to a lot of people. We have to speak like to a lot of the officials. So we're gonna knock every door. We're gonna meet every person that might have the access to Yusuf.
Recently, the Israel-Gaza conflict has led to increased volatility in the region, with Iran-backed militia groups targeting US bases. And IS sleeper cells are re-emerging. They've claimed responsibility for more than 100 attacks in the region since January. SDF checkpoints are everywhere. In Al-Hasika, Mustafa and I meet with Kurdish authorities, a meeting we're not allowed to film. We put forward our request for information on Yusuf Zahab. Whilst we wait for news, we visit the scene where Yusuf was last heard from. In January 2022, a prison in Al-Hasika was attacked by IS militants. Today, the Special Forces commander who led the counterattack is still on high alert. The attack, 2 years ago, was a brazen attempt by Islamic State group militants to free thousands of prisoners. As the battle spilled over into neighbouring suburbs, inside the prison, detained IS suspects overpowered their guards and took control. Four days into the siege, Yusuf's voice emerged from the chaos in the form of a few short audio messages he managed to send to family on a smuggled phone.
My name is Yusuf Zahab, I'm Australian. I'm 17 years old. I need help with getting hit from every side from the girls. I'm very scared. We're just assailing a lot of bodies of kids, 8 years, 10 years, 12 years. My friends got killed here.
Then Yusuf said he'd been badly injured.
I just got shot by Apache. My head's bleeding. I need help, please.
He managed to send a grainy photo showing his bandaged head. His last message, sent on day 6 of the siege, indicated he was about to leave the compound and surrender. After that, silence. After the 10-day battle, the SDF reported more than 500 dead, including 121 of their own soldiers. But although many prisoners reportedly escaped, the SDF would not confirm how many remained unaccounted for.
It was sometime, I think, in June, the Kurds attended at the camp and basically told his mother that we don't have Yusuf anymore. And what that meant was unclear to her. To me, it wasn't so unclear. They had somebody, they no longer have him. Something's happened to him. Then with that as well was somebody, Australian government, leaked to the newspapers that they had a report that Yusuf had passed.
An Australian teenager detained in northeastern Syria has been confirmed dead just months after he pleaded with the government for help.
A memorial service for Yusuf was held at Sydney's Lakemba Mosque. It was a chance for his extended family to grieve.
Yusuf Zahab, I am absolutely devastated with the passing of my innocent nephew.
But then, another twist.
The next bit of information that we received was a year later. DFAT had asked to speak to the relevant family member that was the contact person for Yusuf's case. They then showed a video of Yusuf in that, which apparently was dated September 2022. And in fact, the people that turned up with the video couldn't answer any question that came as a result of that video, where he was, what his current health was like, why it had taken 10 months for this video apparently to arrive in Australia. I will say, as time has gone on and the lack of clarity, it has made me a bit more cynical about the video itself, but that's my view. I know the family are much more hopeful that it is all true, and nothing since has happened to him since that video has come out.
We've set up base in the town of Kemişli on the Turkish border, and we've just received some unexpected news. Kurdish authorities have confirmed Yusuf is alive in an SDF prison, and I can meet him tomorrow. We aren't allowed to film at the prison where Yusuf is being held, so he will be brought to meet us at a secure compound. He was imprisoned as a child at age 15, but I'll be meeting a young man, now aged 20.
All right, record all?
Yep.
Everything rolling.
Okay.
Allah Akbar. Right.
Yes.
Yusuf? Hi, I'm Colin Cozier from SBS Dateline. How are you? Can you tell me again, who are you? And so your family in Australia can kind of verify that you are who you say you are. Can you tell us a little bit about yourself?
Okay. My name is Yusuf Zahab. I still live in Australia, Sydney, Bankstown. I skirted the school called Anuri. Mom's name is Amina. My dad's name is Hisham. My sister's name is Sumaya. Got a brother, two brothers, one called Muhammad, one called Khalid. And I think.
You're Yusuf Zahab.
Yeah.
Can I ask, what's it like being here today talking to me, an Australian guy?
Australian? You're Australian?
I'm Australian. So we're with SBS Dateline program. Do you remember SBS in Australia?
Yeah.
The channel, the TV station, SBS?
I'm not sure. I remember 10 years, 9 years.
The competitors.
Well,
So we've come here to Syria to try and find you. How are you? Nobody's heard anything about you.
I don't know, I'm tired, of course, because of prison and that. Tired, because it's been 5 years now, I haven't seen my family, my mother. I went through a lot of stuff, mostly bad. Day and night, I'm scared. I'm feeling unsafe.
Why do you feel unsafe?
Because of what happened to me before in prison. Because I got tortured before. I got beaten up so much. I got knocked out twice.
By who?
By guards. They were beating us up so much. People, blood coming out of them. I got knocked out twice from the beating. I got blood come out of my nose and that. My mouth, my lips got ripped from how much they used to beat me up on the head, on my body. I remember starvation, very hungry. Then after that, they took me to that place called Hasaka. There, they put me with the kids. Over there, I was literally...
So before this, you were with men?
Yes.
Have Australian authorities come to meet you here?
Once in 2019, only. They came and asked me a few questions about what's going on with me, and that's the last time I saw him.
What about your father? What news have you heard of him?
I actually don't know nothing about him. I don't know, but I'm really concerned more about my mother now because, I don't know, I just love my mother so much. My sister too. I think about him day and night.
Tell me about when you left Sydney.
I was 12 years old. I was in year 7. What I remember is that we sold our house and we were going to buy another house. What my mother and father told me that we're going on a holiday and they were going to come back buy the house. And then from there, I didn't understand what was going on until the day my mother, father, my brother, Khaled was telling me to run, and I was crying and I was scared and holding my mom's hand and running. I didn't know what to do.
Can I just ask, whose idea was that to cross the border into ISIS territory?
I'm not sure, but what I saw, Yanni, what's going on and who's telling my dad and mum to do stuff was my brother, Khaled. But I'm actually not sure. You should ask my mother and father about that.
What was life like under the Islamic State?
Mostly at home. My mother bought me a PlayStation Vita so I can play on it. I had a laptop, used to watch movies on it. Never used to go out much because there used to be hittings from planes and that. Mother was always afraid for me to go out and that, and I was always afraid to go out because of the noise of the planes. It's scary.
I have to ask, when you lived in the Caliphate, did you join the Islamic State?
No, I never joined the Islamic State. And I've got asked that so many times. When I first came to prison, when ASIO saw me, until now. And I don't know why they always ask the same question. But I haven't joined the Islamic State. I've never went to ISIS. I didn't even come. It wasn't me, I came with my family. Why am I in prison? I don't even understand that.
Did your mum and dad support the Islamic State?
Well, I'm not sure about that. Maybe, I don't know. I actually don't know. But what I think is because of my brothers, because of Khaled, because of Muhammad, it's because of them. That's why my mother, father, me, that's why I think that they got us here. They got us into all this trouble and that.
There will be people in Australia who are concerned that because of your time in prison, because you've spent so much time with so many adult men who were Islamic State fighters, that you will have become radicalised in prison. Is that the case, or what do you say to those concerns?
These adults I was with, I never used to sit with them. I never used to get close to them. I used to be scared of them. I have nothing to do with the Caliphate, or I don't know what it's called, ISIS. I just want to be a normal guy, a normal person like everyone else, how they're living their happy lives. I just want to go back and live a happy life too.
If you could have a message for the Australian government, what would you like to say?
That, like, please take me back home. I really want to go back home, live life again, continue my studies because I'm really low in education now, see my family.
Your family in Australia will be thrilled to hear about you and to see you looking well.
Thank you.
Kamal Debussy wanted you to know that they love you and they're thinking of you.
Thank you. Tell him I love him too. And tell him I love him more. And I just want to go back to Australia. So they are, hey, oh, this is happening to me. I want to see my mother. I think every day, like, you're living a normal life. Everyone outside is living a normal life. Just me, I'm through all this shit. Every day, since, I don't know, like 10 years now.
You were just a child.
I don't know, every time people come and ask me, you have something to do with ISIS, I tell them no. He comes interrogates me, like, I got interrogated more than 7 times, I don't know why. Every time, no, you have something to do with ISIS, I tell him no, I have nothing to do with ISIS. They always put me under pressure. Tell my family back in Australia that I love them all. And please don't forgive me. Please don't forget me here. I'm scared I'm gonna die here. So many people died in prison. Please, I just want to get back home. Please.
Finding missing Australian Yusuf Zahab in northeastern Syria proved to be surprisingly easy. Could it be that the timing was right? That the dust had settled since the prison attack? At least today, I can give his mother some news at Al Rosh camp.
I'm about to meet Yusuf's mum and to tell her that he's alive, that we've met him. And I'm going to show her this photo of Yusuf.
We're in Camp Roof. This is where we live.
Amina Zahab has been in detention in a makeshift camp for 5 years, along with her daughter and grandchildren.
Asya, you say hello? Say hello.
In 2022, 17 Australians were repatriated from Al Rosh camp, including Kamal's daughter Mariam. But Amina, along with 41 other Australians, are still waiting in detention camps, living in an information black hole.
This is my tent, and you're welcome. Come in.
Thank you very much. Should we have a chat? Where's a good spot to have a chat?
Wherever you like. What do you think is a good spot?
We'll set up in here.
Okay.
Okay. My name's Amina. I'm from Sydney, New South Wales.
When was the last time you saw Yusuf?
5 years ago.
And what have you heard from him since?
Then I heard that he died. I didn't want to believe it. But it was confirmed from home, from everywhere, you know, like even officials came here. And after about a year, was it a year? I was told that the government contacted a family member back home. They showed her that it was confidential. No one was allowed to look at it except her. They showed her a video of Yusuf. And ever since then, I think the family back home are trying so hard to know his whereabouts. And apparently the government don't know his whereabouts. I beg the families back home not to forget about Yusuf. I beg them. I'm begging you not to forget about Yusuf.
We have some news. We met Yusuf yesterday. He says he loves you. He says he loves you and he hasn't forgotten about you. He thinks about you every day.
You want to hug you? Did he hug you?
We were allowed to speak to him for an hour.
Thank you.
He seemed well. He seemed well.
Healthy, are you sure?
I can show you a photo.
Oh my God.
I took that photo yesterday.
Oh my God. You did something that no one was able to do. Thank you, thank you, thank you, thank you. I can't thank you enough. And I've always hoped that he's going to be a tough boy. He's going to go through it and we're going to see each other. And we're going to meet each other. And just as much as I want to see him here, and I do want to give him a hug, but I always pray that I'd meet him when we're leaving, and I'll just hug him and hold his hand and never leave it again.
Where are you from?
Australia.
There's one more person I need to talk to.
It's called Kamal.
Hi, Colin, how are you?
Hey, Kamal, I said I'd check in if we had some news, and we do have some news about Yusuf. We met Yusuf in person the other day.
You've met Yusuf? That is huge. How is he?
He seemed okay. He seemed okay. He told us his name. He told us where he grew up in Sydney and what school he went to. And he told us his whole story from leaving Sydney until today. And it's quite a story.
That's amazing.
I thought you'd like that news.
I love that news. I don't know what else to say.
Begs the question, right? If it was that easy
for an Australian television crew to come and talk to the guy, why were we the first Australians that Yusuf has spoken to in 5 years?
There's a lot of questions, but that's a very obvious one.
I am honestly lost for words at the moment. I'm just so happy that he's alive, and I'm so happy for the family as well. But what a roller coaster they've been put through.
What really got to him, Kamal, was your message. Your message that
the family loves him and hasn't forgotten. That really moved him. It really moved him.
Thank you. Thank you, Colin. Okay. Yeah, it's a where to from here, I suppose, is our challenge at the moment. Yeah. Thank you, Colin.
We have some footage that we can show you. So when you get off this telephone call, you can look at a little bit of footage of Yusuf.
Kamal Tabusi wanted you to know that they love you and they're thinking of you.
Thank you. Tell him I love him too. And tell him I love him more. And I just want to go back to Australia. Something like that.
Alaikum assalam wa barakatuh, guys. I've just got off the phone with Colin in Syria. They have met and interviewed Yusuf yesterday, their time.
Alhamdulillah.
It's the first time he's spoken to any Australian in 5 years.
No, habibi.
And they're going to share some more information with us as soon as they can.
Dateline contacted the Minister's offices at Home Affairs, Foreign Affairs and the Prime Minister and Cabinet with questions about Yusuf Zahab. They did not respond to our questions. SDF officials deny Yusuf was tortured. They say they're doing their best to provide medical help to prisoners, including dangerous IS suspects. Next week on Dateline, Yusuf's story continues. If you could see Yusuf, what would you say to him?
I'm sorry. I want to say sorry to him.
Will more Australian boys follow Yusuf into the prison system?
If they take them away from me, I might never see them again. I don't know what they'll do to them.
And does the repatriation of IS suspects and their families create too much political controversy?
We need to go down and kick down the doors of Parliament. No, we need to get their attention.
The basic rule of international law is each country is responsible for its own.
Why do you think you've been left here?
I don't know why. That's the question I wish to ask you.